Thank you. Thank you for the young webinar hosting team, my friend Shuo, Soma, Liberty from UC Davis, Jacinta from Canada, Neha from Adelaide. It was really heartening when this young group of budding scientists have started this non-profit platform to bring in and showcase the best in research that is happening in plant science. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. I should be speaking on genomic assisted breeding for chickpea improvement, basically concentrating on the work that has been principally taken up by the chickpea molecular breeding group at ICAR, particularly at IRA, that's my lab. Whenever we look at sustainable development, which actually means that that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generation. So this includes five things, whether you are looking, when you are looking at prosperity, to ensure prosperity, here we look at farmers' prosperity and soil sustainability, to look at peace, that is meeting hunger, to look at partnerships for research and frontiers, to protect our natural resources, and to weigh that we overcome the things. But what are the major challenges when we look down at international agriculture per se, so that we have a look into why this becomes that we need to apply these modern breeding tools for crop improvement program. Population is burgeoning at a whooping rate. India itself is adding the whole of Australia and Europe in every year, and we have more mouths to feed. And if you look down, this is happening with limited arable land. Most of the arable land, which is besides rivers, getting converted into what you call as housing and other things, and an increasing water scarcity, rising climate, and with increased CO2 levels. So the big challenge is we need to now create more food. This more food needs to be created using less resources. The less resources include less arable land, less water, less labor, and even migration of already available agricultural labor, as well as farmers who find industry and other petty jobs as more remunerative. At the same time, we also understand that the water footprints to produce 1 kg of a particular crop is very high, and is much so higher in case of animal products. So the whole idea is that we need to increase the food production almost by a staggering 60% by 2050, hardly 30 years, to feed our rapid growing population. And this indicates much higher than the 1.9% annual growth that we got it. So where does this translational genomics, when we are basically speaking, fit into agriculture? We do understand the most important is development of advanced breeding lines or development of varieties. But this is not a, what you say, a step in its own. A lot of pre-breeding activities, as well as translational genomic activities, or what you call as the related crop activities take place. The whole idea is that we need to have variability so that the breeder is able to select this variability for utilizing in crop improvement. And where does this variability come from? This particular variability comes from the germplasm, right? So whether we have by now a lot of plant genetic resources, research that has gone by the way of developing cores, by the way of developing mini cores, or using focused intensive germplasm screening approach, FIGS approach, as well as some of the breeders who have developed nested association mapping populations or multi-parent advanced generation intercross or the mapping populations. These all form the genetic resources or the germplasm material which were resourced by using the land races, the cultivars or wilds which are present in the gene bank, and the use of computational or the genomic resources has made us identify the quantitative linked loci or genomic estimated breeding values or the phenotyping techniques, including the lysimeter or the more modern phenomics facilities, which gave us idea of which are the genes that are functioning, or if not, which are the QTLs that are linked to the various genes that are actually going, and how these are actually inherited, or maybe simple breeding tools which give you to understand the stability of certain characters as well as the genotypes. So once this information is available, we start moving towards what is called as genomic assisted breeding, pre-breeding, or the conventional breeding to have a large set of segregating lines on which selection can be made. Now, if you look into the history of plant breeding, as I said, variability is must and selection of superior types was essential. Earlier, the breeders in before 1900 were following what we call as phenotypic selections, isn't it? So slowly what happened is Mendel introduced his what you call as principles, and then slowly we have moved into the cytogenetics principle by the Morgan group, and then we started looking at with Sir Ronald A. Fisher the biometrical techniques that have come to play. And when the biometrical techniques have come to play, lot of the people who were using initially the phenotypic variances started looking with this belief whether this would greatly help or not. With the analysis of variants and application of biometrical techniques, we have got a statistical tool with which we validate our results. And then the cycle continued. And as the tissue culture techniques of 1970 to the 2000, where the genomic techniques started coming into play, I myself remember as a student in 1995 to 98 at IRA, where we were using the isozymes and the rapid markers just came into play, and we were a bit very new to these techniques, but the world was looking to whether this would actually solve. But let me tell you, these are the tools. And what happens is, it is important that the breeders or the crop improvement persons, including in any field, use these tools to increase your precision of experiments or increase your precision of selection, or prevent what you call as lag, so that you are able to actually target the trait of interest. Exactly like my close friend and collaborator Rajiv Varshney puts it, so we have come into a stage where we have now 5 G's for crop improvement, which they published in Current Opinion and Plant Biology. If you look down, one is the genome. So you require to have the whole genome assembly for a given crop species. Legumes initially, and particularly pulses, were orphan crops, but thanks to the efforts of ICADA, ICRISAT, including Saskatchewan and other universities, what happened is we now have a large genome assembly for most of the legume crops, which are widely grown, and particularly so of chickpea. See, the availability of genome assembly gives us an idea that we can use the bioinformatics tools to identify the gene complexes. At the same time, having germplasm characterized at the genomic level as well as agronomic level will help us to identify the genes of interest. But most important is we are moving to how we can use this in genomic breeding. I'm not speaking of just marker assisted breeding, but I'm looking at genomic breeding where we use the modern genomic approaches, that is genomic estimated breeding values. And of course, slowly the new technology of gene editing is coming. So as we move on, we understand that we have marker assisted selection or marker assisted backcrossing or marker assisted recurrent selection. The availability of these tightly linked markers, which we use in the forward breeding or genomic selection approaches. So you all know, but for the global audience in general, I would like to say that chickpea is one of the largest grown legume or the pulse crop in the country. It is first in India, and it stands second after peas, dry peas. Now, it is not only that, it has a large amount of medicinal properties, and India contributes to more than 90% area, more than 90% of the production. But alas, when we start looking at the productivity, it is roughly stagnating to less than 1 ton per hectare over years. Now, there is a huge gap between this potential yield, that is about 3 to 5 tons per hectare that has been achieved, and the average yield that is still less than 1 ton. And it is now that we are started looking how do we start to reduce this particular achievable yield with that that we are achieving, even in what you call as production plots. So when we are looking at such things, we look that the program of chickpea, particularly in India, is actually rooted through Indian Institute of Pulse Research under the directorship of Dr. N.P. Singh and coordinating by Dr. G.P. Dikshit. And we have about five zones, each zone characterized by a specific angle. For example, we have the Northwest Plain Zone, which was once the heartthrob of chickpea production. But from 1990s, 80s to 90s, this whole production started moving to the central and southern India. And this what we call as the South Zone and the Central Zone, and Madhya Pradesh is rightly called as the pulse state, where a large amount of pulses, not only chickpea, including other pulses, are produced. Every zone is characterized by certain priority traits, which we have been doing. And we started this exercise in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation project. For example, for Central and South India, I broadly grouped them. We require early maturing, high temperature and drought tolerant varieties. At the same time, biotic resilience to dry root rot, wilt, collar rot resistance. In case of Kabuli, we are looking at 100 seed weight of 50 grams or more, which is called as the extra large seeded Kabuli, and we are moving slowly towards mechanized harvesting. An excellent program, which is now bearing fruit, started by Dr. Gaur and group from ICRISAT, as well as partners from the National Agricultural Research System. Now we are looking towards east. East, when I mean to say Northeast Plains, which also includes Eastern UP, Bihar, West Bengal, Plains of Assam, Orissa, where we are looking at not only high temperature and short duration tolerance, but looking at wilt and water rate is gray mold. And when I'm looking at the Northwest Plain zones, we are looking at cold, Ascochyta blight, wilt resistance. So now you see, I am a breeder who is working from the northern part of the country, but my major area lies in the central and the south zone, and the area in future which I am looking to is Northeast Plain zones. So you need to try to look what are the basic needs and necessities of this zone. And if you look into the area production and yield of chickpea, as we look down, particularly if you look at yield graph, we did increase, but then there was no substantial increase in the productivity per hectare. We may argue that yes, we take more than one crop per year, but certainly when your own research productivity indicates 3 to 5 tons, it is not so actually showing in the farmer's level. See, there are two advantages if you are able to achieve this. One, you will be able to relieve more land to other crops. We require a cafeteria of different crops, not only chickpea alone. Then, since if we are able to increase this productivity from marginal lands, we will be providing resilience to this resource poor farmer. And this was the target of the present regime or present research focus. So as I'm saying, so what are these strategies that we are looking into? As I said, whether it is the genetic resources or the genomic resources, what we are trying to basically target is the genes. Utilize these genes into the improvement of crops, whether using the conventional approaches or the marker-assisted approaches or the genetic engineering technologies to provide genotypes. That means what we are trying to do, we are trying to better predict the phenotypes from the genotype or the gene information that we have. And this is where an integrated approach of the physiologists, the biochemists, the agronomists, as well as stabilizing scientists, that is the entomologists and the pathologists, come into role into a pool, and we need to use it. So whenever we are looking at genomic assisted breeding, leave aside in chickpea, or if you are using in any other crop, so you require certain criteria for the full utilization of these modern molecular tools. Number one, these are not going to supplant the breeder. They're going to supplement the breeder. So you need to have a robust breeding program. It is not a panacea. It is a good aid tool. So you need to have a very robust breeding program. Mind you, We need to have a large scale field screening. What I mean to say is large scale field screening is you need to have precise phenotyping tools. Without precise phenotyping tools, over locations, over environments, you'll be actually making a molecular phenotype again, which will be of no usefulness. And you may end up developing QTLs, which are different for different locations. Let's say if I'm doing phenotyping at Hyderabad, if I'm doing phenotyping at UW at Perth, if I'm doing phenotyping at Delhi with the same population, and if I am not able to reduce the environmental effect, that means if my phenotyping is not precise, then what happens is I'll be having different QTLs for different places. And a new rubber breeder who starts with this will be confused. Then we need to have the people who can actually use these tools precisely, who can use this, understand which tool to be used where. Now this becomes very, very important. In most of my classes, when I start to it, I start with a simple way of making you understand that you have a group of subjects, right? Let's say this group is about 500 and odd people who have joined into the webinar. This group consists of both the male and the female, right? Now, if I use gender as a tool of classification, these 500 group people or the 500 subjects will be classified just into two groups, the male group and the female group. If I use, let's say, geographical isolation as a criteria, the same group which has been classified into two groups, there will be intermixing and maybe we'll have 5 or 7. Or if I start using age as a criteria, maybe 8 groups. You see, the number of subjects which I've taken is same, they're the 500. But when I use a different statistical intervention, what basically happens is the grouping changes. Similarly, these are all interventions that you are going to use. For example, if you are going to use just the morphological D-square analysis, you have with the same subjects two different groups. You are using a principal component analysis, same subject, some other groups. If you are using SSR markers, same subject, different groups. Is the grouping wrong? Not at all. So as a breeder or as a person who is making this group, it is pertinent of you to understand why are you making this group. For example, you have a very, very large germplasm and you want to fastly delineate them into homogeneous groups. Then using a simple metroglyph technique, which uses the two most variable characters, is just sufficient. And within this smaller homogeneous groups, you may use a principal component approach to have much more precise, closely related groups. And within them, you may use the molecular tools. This is very, very essential so that you are able to handle your resources more importantly. You certainly require a strong biotechnology and bioinformatics team. And most important, you require an healthy interdisciplinary approach, not to supplant each other duties, but to supplement each other. So that's how we do it, particularly in my lab, where we have a strong breeding and research program group, and we work as a marker service lab. We also use the facilities of ICRISAT and ICARDA to actually strengthen our breeding program along with the National Institute of Agricultural Biotechnology. The markers have been evolving. I've been speaking this thing in the initial stages. While I started my career, as I said, we started with isogenes, then came the RFLPs, and now we are under the SNP or DART. But how are these useful? They are useful in different programs. For example, I structured my lecture in a way that means in, for example, diversity analysis, in development of maps, in utilizing these QTLs identified by various mapping techniques in marker-assisted breeding program and genomic-assisted breeding program. And so similarly, I'll be taking you in the saga of journey of my 22 years of scientific ladder. When you start looking, what basically happened is when we started looking at the chickpea breeding, everywhere we were hearing, and including an analysis that we have done and my students have done, we have seen that the base, the genetic base of chickpea was very narrow, and we were actually unable to get large amount of genetic gains. Was it actually narrow? So this was what we started doing, and we published one in way back in 2011. Later, one of my students, Sneha Priya, who is also working along with ICARDA, Dr. Sarkar, Dr. Shiv Kumar Agrawal, Tapan and Richvi, what we have done is we were able to obtain about 166 land races. As you can see, some of them are from the Vana region, that is the West Asia and the North Africa region. Some of them were from the Indian subcontinent. They were spread across the globe. And what we have started looking is, we started also obtaining those lines which were available in the ICRISAT germplasm, basically of the Indian origin. We also looked at the National Agricultural Research System derived and developed lines and varieties. We also started looking at those which were wild species and started using a clustering technique, and we could see that was a clear-cut branching. That means this clearly indicated the lines of the Vana region, West Asia and North Africa, those that were from these regions, certainly were quite diverse, irrespective of whether they were the lines from different areas in India or from the ICRISAT germplasm of the Indian origin. This actually indicated that we can actually achieve greater gains by using these lines in a pre-breeding approach. And what we started doing is, we started developing robust mapping populations using these lines with specific traits. And we started looking whether we can start using them in development of maps. There were already a large number of maps when we had published this particular map developed in the country from my collaborator and co-author also, Dr. Sabyata Bhatia, Dr. Varshney and group, as well as Winter and Huttle. But what we have seen when we have seen of these maps is, most of these maps have used wild derivatives or reticulatum into arytenum crosses. Beautiful maps developed, a large amount of polymorphism, but when we started using most of these polymorphic markers in the cultivated lines, none of them amplified. Maybe one of the reason of this is that these were actually skewed towards showing polymorphism of the wild genomic pool or the land race pool. And that's where we hit upon the idea that, can we develop a map using Desi into Kabuli? And when we started developing, this was a very, sparse map, as you call it as. But this was the first Desi into Kabuli or intraspecific map in the country, or second in the world after Cobos et al. And what we started now looking is, can we actually increase the density of the markers that were available? And along with Dr. Sabyata Bhatia in an Indo-Canadian pulse genomics initiative with University of Saskatchewan, we started looking at how to saturate this particular map, characterize them for various yield parameters. The both of the mapping populations were both the mapping population was quite sound, with one of the parent, which we call as simple Desi mutant, which had almost 100 seed weight of 35 grams. And we used it with a BGD 112, a green leaf seeded, green seeded and stay green variety, which had seed weight of 16 grams. And we could actually develop a large number of novel ESTs, 367. And then we could actually place about 131 markers onto this, again done by Shefali, Dr. Sabyata's student, and Tapan, my student. And we could actually saturate this map to a greater length. But still we found that of the QTLs that we have identified, there was a wide gap for these yield QTLs, and we thought we need to actually